Harper Audio presents Red and Me by Bill Russell with Alan Steinberg. Read by Peter J. Fernandez. Prologue read by Bill Russell. Copyright 2009 by Bill Russell. Production copyright 2009 by HarperCollins Publishers.
Red Auerbach and I were friends our whole adult lives, almost 50 years. But we never talked about it. That was part of why the friendship worked. He always knew he was one of the few people I cared a great deal about. And I always knew that I was one of the few people that he cared a great deal about. It didn't have to be said. When I joined the Boston Celtics in 1956, I didn't know much about Red Auerbach as a coach, and I didn't care about him. Since my relationship with my previous coaches in college and on the U.S. Olympic team were unfriendly, I just expected another adversarial relationship with a coach, and I was completely comfortable with that. But when I arrived in Boston after the Olympics, Red was secure within himself, and I was secure within myself. So, he didn't have to prove to me he was a great coach, and I didn't have to prove that I was a great player. Although we came from different tribes as men, we recognized early that as professionals, we had a common agenda: to win basketball games. As our basketball relationship played out, we also realized that, philosophically, we shared the same perspectives on life. Our core philosophies of how to be men, how to be professionals, and how to be friends were in tune. So we never had to talk about who we were or how to conduct ourselves. We just lived it. Over the next 13 years, basketball set the stage for our relationship to evolve from caution to admiration to trust and respect, to a friendship that lasted a lifetime. After I retired in 1969, Red and I didn't see each other very often. But even though I lived in Seattle and he lived in Washington, D.C., we each remained a strong presence in the other's life. A few times a year, we'd end up in Boston at the same time. If the Celtics were home, we'd go to see a game together at the Fleet Center. The rest of the time, we kept our relationship current by phone. In 2005, when Red's health deteriorated, I phoned regularly to let him know I was thinking about him. He was getting lots of calls. I also knew that when people aren't doing well, they spend a lot of time and energy telling their friends not to worry. I didn't want to drain Red's energy for my benefit, so I kept the conversation short. All I cared about was that this was my friend, and all he cared about was he was hearing from his friend. I remember our last conversation, weeks before he died, as vividly as our championships together half a century ago. He answered the phone with his famous cranky growl. "What? Red? Who is this? Still cranky. This is William F. Russell. Hey, Russ, how you doing?" "I'm all right. The question is, how are you doing?" "Well, you know, it's day to day. Doesn't get any better. But don't worry about it. I'm okay." He didn't want anyone to feel sorry for him, ever. His attitude in life was still exactly like mine. "I can take care of myself, and I don't need anybody's pity." "Is there anything I can do to help?" "Nah, if I need anything from you, I'll call you." "All right, see you later." That was it, short and to the point, like almost all our conversations. Of course, I didn't know it would be our final one, but, though a lot was left unsaid, I have no regrets. We understood each other completely. That was the foundation of our friendship. It's the foundation of all lasting friendships. Years ago, I came up with a saying that expresses it precisely. I don't know whether I heard it somewhere or made it up, but it became part of who I am. It's far more important to understand than to be understood. Before they last called to Red, my wife Marilyn and I had already arranged a trip to the East Coast in mid-October. After stopping in Orange County, California, so I could play in a celebrity golf tournament that raises money for the Susan G. Komen Breast Cancer Foundation, we drove to Hyannisport, Massachusetts, for the Robert F. Kennedy Memorial Golf Tournament. I knew Red's health wouldn't get any better, and my old Celtics teammate Frank Ramsey, who lived in Kentucky, had some health issues from the year before. So I thought it was time to see both of them again. When we arrived at Red's home in D.C., his housekeeper let us in. Red came out, we hugged, and he led us into his den, slowly, using a cane. He sat in his favorite big chair and set the cane on the floor. We started talking about life, where he was in his and where I was in mine. I said, "You know, I think I finally found a partner." He knew that I met Marilyn because he'd met her at the Celtics games a few years back. But I hadn't shared much about our relationship. We never discussed our private affairs, unless one of us had a good reason to ask. He said, "That's great, Russ. I'm glad for you." He gave me a wink. "I know you've been by yourself." I said, "Well, you know, that Donnie used to say about me." He brightened at the mention of her name. She had been his wife for 59 years before passing away 6 years ago. "Donnie said a lot of things about you." "Which one?" "When I met you both the first time at your reception party, she told you, 'I'm so glad you drafted him. What a nice young man.'" "Oh yeah," he snorted. "You sure fooled her." It was Red's usual Brooklyn Jewish needle, his way of expressing friendliness. We both used to needle each other all the time. I said, "She was my biggest fan." "So?" "So, Red, that's how I feel about Marilyn." My big laugh rolled into his little one. It was good to see him cheered. Then we discussed the long drive to D.C. He said, "You always did love driving, didn't you? What happened to that sports car you had? You still driving that thing like a maniac?" He meant my Lamborghini. He used to needle me like hell about the day when I was coaching Celtics. I drove into a snowstorm before a game. It's a very low-slung car with almost no underclearance, so I ended up in a snowbank. I didn't make it to the game till the last quarter, and Red had to come out of the stands to coach. "Nope," I smiled proudly. "We're driving a nice, slow minivan." It's come to that, huh? I knew that it still bothered him not driving anymore. Until he got sick, he always drove himself everywhere in a convertible with the license plate Celtics. I laughed, remembering the time he was scheduled to speak at a school and they sent a limousine for him. But he just found the limousine in his car. We ended up discussing basketball. He said, "Jesus Christ, those goddamn players today, they don't know their asses from a hole in the ground. I blame the coaches. They call a timeout and it looks like a mob scene. All these assistant coaches talking to each other and then 4 or 5 seconds to the players. What the hell can you tell a player in 5 seconds? You ever see anything as dumb as that? You don't need any of these goddamn assistants. You end up coaching them instead of the players." He was back in his element. But I didn't want to get him drained, so I finally stood up to leave. "Okay, Red," I said, "we have to get going." When Marilyn and I reached the door, I told Red, matter-of-factly, "I'll see you later." As I turned to leave, he called out, "Wait a minute, wait a minute." He got up out of his chair and shuffled to us gingerly on his cane. "Listen, Russ," he said earnestly, just like one of our private player-coach meetings, "this is something important. When you get old, don't fall, because that's the start of the end. So remember, don't fall." It caught me off guard. "Okay, Red," I assured him. "I'll do my best not to." In the past, our saying goodbye was, as we both like to say, "no big deal." This felt different, and it struck me, for one thing, he'd made a big effort to get up and walk over to me and deliver the message. For another, I knew he'd taken a fall a few months earlier, and when a lot of people get old, they're doing okay, and then they fall, and they never recover from it. When Marilyn and I got outside, I smiled to myself. I realized that when Red said, "Don't fall," it was really a warning to his friend. "When you get old, be careful. Take care of yourself." That comforted me. He was expressing affection. We never did that openly with each other. It was always unspoken. We both grew up with certain macho assumptions in our era about how men expressed their feelings. One was that a man always was careful not to say, "I love you," to another man. Even today, men don't say, "I really like you," to their friends, or even "we're friends." So we developed other ways to communicate these feelings. But then we moved on quickly. We never dwelled on that stuff long. We switched to the next agenda. Once Meryl and I were in the car, it occurred to me that Red's warning not to fall was something a woman might call tender. A tender gesture of friendship. It touched me deeply. As sick as he was, as frail as he felt, he was thinking of his friend. He was thinking of me. As we drove away, I reveled in that moment. And in our little visit, I thought, I'm sure glad I did that. But then pretty fast, "Now, tomorrow morning, let's get back on the road."
Chapter 1. Common Ground. To me, friendship is simple. The way I like to picture it is this famous photo of Einstein standing at a blackboard filled with long, complicated equations that add up to a short one at the bottom. E equals mc squared. The genius was not only that he understood those long equations and what could be done with them, but also his ability to condense them into the short one that defined them. My relationship with Red Auerbach was those complicated equations on Einstein's board. Our E equals mc squared was the simple friendship that defined them. I have a finite number of friends. I keep that number small and it never changes. Someone once asked me, "What happens when you make a new friend?" I laughed. Someone has to go. The fact is, throughout my life, and it's been a very full one, I've had only a few dear friends. Each one is completely different. But Red was a special one, and probably the most unexpected. Our relationship can't be described by logic. There was no apparent reason we ever should have been friends. We came from different tribes and places. An immigrant stock Jewish white man from New York and a rural black guy from segregated Louisiana by way of inner-city California projects. Yet we found a way to meet on common ground. That was what made the friendship unique. I can't speak for Red about what he brought from his tribe, but I can relate some of the key lessons I learned from mine. Starting with the fact that the first thing I knew as a person was that both my parents loved me. Their unconditional love was the most valuable thing I could get from them. It shaped my character and built my foundation. My respect and love for them has lasted my entire life. Since I came from the deep south of the 1930s and 40s, it wasn't a foregone conclusion that I would ever be open to befriending a white person. But by listening to my family and observing how they conducted their lives, I absorbed core values: respect, integrity, trust, honesty, loyalty, fairness, independence, empathy, that prepared me to be open to Red Auerbach. They were educators that way. They knew what was important in life, and they lived it every day, through example and the spoken word. My father, whom I always called Mr. Charlie, inherited his values from his father, for whom he had enormous respect, admiration, and affection. Grandpa Russell was a tough-minded, hard-working, independent farmer sharecropper who kept his own mule team and worked for himself. He was more stubborn than his mules, and he wouldn't tolerate an insult to his dignity or to his family. To me, he was truly a great man, the very essence of manhood. My father told me wonderful stories about his father that I never forgot. These stories taught me, as Mr. Charlie always put it, how to survive in the world and prosper with your manhood intact. One important story was about how, when my father was born, Grandpa Russell realized there were no schools for black children in the area.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.